today we have Mr. Mahendra Vyas with us, who's an advocate with the Supreme Court of India. I think one of the most important things that I can tell you about him is that for most of his life, he has been passionate about the outdoors, about wildlife, and about the environment. Though he is a lawyer and has been working on many issues, one of the central focuses of his work has been the well-being of India's environment. He has a very long, very impressive career. More of that can be read on the site with the link. Welcome to the conversation on big cats. And thank you for sharing with us this really, really important work that the entire legal machinery and especially the Supreme Court of India is doing to protect the environment of the country. I'm really looking forward to this conversation with you.
Thank you for inviting me. I look forward to this session.
So please tell us, over the last few decades, we've seen that the Supreme Court has played more and more of an important role in helping us protect the environment, controlling pollution, ensuring that development takes cognizance of the fact that environmental security is also important for this country.
See, I can tell you one thing, that the Supreme Court has been extremely sensitive about the environmental issues and conservation of forests and wildlife. And they have not done something very, very out of the way. They have not gone. They have actually enforced the law. They have struck the balance between development and conservation. So they have done the Balancing Act has been done very well. And in fact, I must straight away tell you, I showed a book, a compilation of Supreme Court orders to Mr. George Schaller. And these were the earlier orders which we shown. And he came back again after about 6-8 months to India. And he was astounded by the kind of orders which the court has passed. The extreme, he said, I can't believe that Supreme Courts can pass such orders. And he was absolutely, he was so impressed by the kind of sensitivity the court has shown. So that is one of the reactions which responses I have got from a person who was a living legend.
Yeah, I mean, we've heard again and again and again that India is blessed because it has some of the best legislation concerning wildlife anywhere in the world. So could you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
See, we can start right from the Constitution of India. The Constitution itself says that, there are duties which the state has to perform for protection of forests and wildlife, and there are duties which a citizen have to perform. So they start with there. And then there is Article 21, which is right to life, which is a fundamental right. Now, the court has expanded the definition by saying that right to life is not animal existence, but actually a wholesome life where you have a clean air, clean environment, forests. And under Article 21, people have gone to the Supreme Court and sought protection for forests, tigers, elephants. So under Article 21 itself, a lot of environmental jurisprudence has actually developed in India, whether it is protection of elephant corridors, whether it is when you protect elephant corridors, you also protect corridors for the cats and other animals. So if you starting point is Article 21 in India. So a whole lot of plethora of judgments have come, and it is a very rich judgments. If you see, it's a fabulous chronology of judgments which we have, including you have Kudremukh closure of mines, you have a number of cases which have come. So if you see, this is in fact one of the constitution is starting point, which is the basic law from where all other laws actually originate. And then we have four or five laws which are very important. One is the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which has actually two ways in which it protects forests and wildlife and the species. One is the habitat protection. It protects the habitat by declaring national parks and sanctuaries. And then there is a schedule of species with degree of protection is given under the schedules. So you also protect the species. The interesting thing is that in other countries, the species are protected only in the national parks or nature reserves or something. In India, they are protected inside, outside, even in your backyard. A person can, in self-defense, can kill an animal, but otherwise they enjoy protection everywhere, whether it is inside or outside, which is unique. I have seen in many countries, the moment an animal steps outside that imaginary line which we have drawn, which he doesn't know, they are shot. But that doesn't happen in India. They are protected even outside. So this is how another landmark, I would say, legislation in India is the Forest Conservation Act, which came in 1980. This act actually prohibits diversion of forest lands for non-forest use. The states are actually owning the forest lands, and the central government regulates it performs the regulatory function. So any proposal for diversion of forest land for non-forest use has to go to the central government. The central government then puts conditions, either rejects it or puts conditions. Under those conditions, only those can be. And in 12-12-96 order in the forest matter, the definition of forest has been enlarged. Not only the notified forest come under the Forest Conservation Act, even deemed forest comes under, which forest-like areas are also protected under it. So if you want to divert a forest-like area also for non-forest use, you have to go through the FC Act clearance. So if you see a very large area which is habitat for wildlife has come under regulation. Only not the notified, but very large area has come. With the result that there is a speed breaker which has come, which actually stops the indiscriminate diversion of forest lands for non-forest use. So this is the way you protect the habitat. So these two acts are very, very important. Wildlife Protection Act and Forest. Indian Forest Act, of course, talks about reservation of forest. Reservation of forest is that all rights are actually taken over. Some concessions are given in these areas. Otherwise, it is a heavily protected area. You also have a notified protected forest where you have large areas which are protected forests, where most of the activities are allowed, but only certain activities are prohibited. In reserve forest, it is the other way around. All activities are prohibited except what concessions are there. So if you see this regime, a large area provides habitat to wildlife. And of course, they perform the important functions of carbon sequestration, moderation of climate, all those functions which forests perform, they all perform this way. There is an interesting thing which developed. The EP Act, that is called the Environment Protection Act of 1986, was generally thought that it is only for protection of environment, for pollution purposes and all, for regulating air and water pollution and other problems of pollution. But there was a convergence that even EP Act has been used to manage forests. This is another development which came through this forest bench of the forest matter, which went on in the Supreme Court for about 20 years. In fact, in 1995 it is going on, that statutory authorities were created under the EP Act to declare areas ecologically sensitive areas where the development is regulated, not stopped, regulated, but very strictly regulated. So those are also one of the EP Act has also been used for protection of habitat.
Okay, wow. Also, there's another, a lot of people talk about the eco-sensitive zones that you just mentioned. And also the belt around our coastline, which is protected. Can you tell us something about those as well?
Coastal regulation zone actually is a very complicated notification. It has to be actually what is the high tide from the high tide area, how much area. So as you go further, as you go closer, the restrictions are stricter. in the coastal areas. As you go further, the restrictions are relaxed. So this is the way it operates. But it's a miracle, I would say, that with a population of about 400 persons per square kilometer in this country, with 100 and you see, it's a very populous country. In spite of that, we have so many national parks, we have so many wild animals. You see, the species diversity is actually staggering. The species diversity, I can say, it is only it's a miracle that we are able to protect. And the credit should go to the people who tolerate wildlife in their backyard also. The enormous amount of sacrifices have been, I would say, because of the tolerance and sacrifice of the people only, we have been able to have. Not because of we have guards with guns and equipments to stop. But generally, the tolerances and the sacrifice is immense. See the amount of people who get killed by elephants in India. See the number of people who have been killed by tigers. Can you imagine? In Maharashtra, there were 12 deaths by a tigress. And yet, people were still saying that, you know, we should not kill the tigress because it has two cubs. You know, that kind of, you can't expect people to keep on... So we must have some balance that, you know, you cannot this and people living in cities, conservationists expect people living in rural areas and next to forests to sacrifice. I mean, that kind of sacrifice expecting is actually, you have to have a very realistic way of looking at things. You cannot. So I was in fact in the court when this people were trying to, some of the petitioners were trying to push that no, this tigress should not be killed, even after killing and eating the kills, human kills, that it should not be killed because it has two cubs. So I was trying to tell them that you come with me and stay without arms and with arms also in a hut in the area where the tigress is operating. And then spend one night, then you will know that how difficult it is that what sacrifices our people, our people living in forests are making to ensure that wildlife survive. This is one of the things which is most important. Apart from the laws, the other issues, up to a point, laws will help. Beyond that, you'll have to go beyond laws. We have all the laws. We have one of the best judgments. We have got so many judgments we have in our favor for protecting and translocating Asiatic lion, whether it is protection of buffalo, Asiatic buffalo. It's a whole lot of charging net present value for diversion of forest land. That means that you have to actually estimate, monetize the services of the forest. Aesthetic, sequestration, apart from the stump value and all that, or the timber value, which is other tangible but so looks like intangible values, those have to be monetized. Those are also taken, which is a quite substantial amount, which comes as a result that we have accumulated about 57,000 crores of fund entirely because of Supreme Court, which is kept, government has kept it in a separate account to be used for forest protection, for consolidation of protected areas. So if you see, a lot has happened in the last 20, 25, 30 years.
But a lot of controversy also rages about the fact that decisions take so long to come, you know, and people often need something to happen today. Case in point, you know, what is happening, for instance, today in Assam with that oil spill and, you know, in Dehing Patkai and animals being killed and this oil spreading. They can't afford the luxury of waiting 3 years for a decision to happen, because by then the damage would have been so much that the system would take a very long time to recover, if it ever recovered.
See, there are two things. What you are saying about the oil spill, it's an accident. We probably, there is a technological problem. We don't have the kind of technology to deal with the issue. So it is something which doesn't happen very frequently. Fortunately, we have been very fortunate in so far so far that these accidents of oil spills have taken very, very small amount. It doesn't. But yes, this one is a very disturbing this thing, and I'm sure that all other pipelines and other wells and all, they will have to take full precaution, and they should stop open. They should be able to control this fire as soon as possible because of some technical problems. We are not very, our oil industry is not very oil, is not very big. It's in a, and those gaps are there, technological gaps are. We need to fill those gaps, and we should not. Secondly, you are saying that it takes time. In democracy, everything takes time. We have opted for democracy, and democracy is a slow process where checks and balances keep you know, kicking in at every stage, and we have opted it, and it is the best system with all its delays and small problems which we see. It is still the best system, I believe. Most of us would agree that it is the best system.
There's also a lot of discussion generally about the dichotomy between species and parks being the heritage of all citizens of India and being controlled by the central government versus the fact that right now they are actually under state control. So it's a different way of looking at a situation and dealing with the situation, because state governments look at it within their state boundaries.
Yes.
And central government does not interfere more than a certain amount with managing these resources. So how does one deal with this? Legally, what is the position?
See, legally, you have to go back to 1976, the 42nd, the Indian Constitution, mm-hmm. where we found that in our headlong rush to develop, we were actually ignoring, this was felt by the government and the parliament, that we are probably ignoring forests and wildlife. So the forests and wildlife were listed in list 2, that is the state list. There are 3 lists in the constitution in the 7th schedule. List 1 has all the subjects on which the parliament is competent to make laws. List 2 is exclusively subjects listed in that list 2 which the state legislatures are competent to make laws. List 3 is the list in which concurrent laws are, the concurrent list, where both can legislate, but the central parliamentary law will prevail over the state law, because we have a federal system of governance in India with a unitary bias, which is a bias toward the central, because after all, if you see our history, we had a 600 odd states, small, big states, which had to be, you know, stitched together to form a union. And we don't want that, you know, at that time, the importance was that we should stay together, and it was important, that was more important. So the list one, so we had a concurrent list that, you know, there will be overriding powers with the central government. That was the system which adopted. But if you see the wildlife forests, the subject is with the state government. It is the owner, the land is owned by the state. Today, if the central government wants to give even a bamboo to a person, one bamboo, it cannot. Or if it wants to give a 1 square yard to anybody, a lot, it cannot. The lease is also given by, but regulation is central government. In 42nd amendment in 1970s, they said that since it's an important thing, so each state might feel that I have a lot of forests. But if you see on a national perspective, one state may have a lot of forests, but say Rajasthan, Haryana doesn't have forests that much. So you have to take a holistic, the whole of country and then take a decision that, you know, you can't divert forests like this. So from list 2, forest and wildlife were transferred to list, concurrent list, where both can be. In case of conflict of the laws made by the state on those subject in the concurrent list, the laws made by the state subject, if it fall in conflict with the central law, because both are making laws, parliament also makes state legislature. If there is a conflict, the central law will prevail. So under that, if you see, the regulatory functions have come with the forest regulation, particularly is with the central government. But if a proposal comes for diversion from the state for a particular project, let us say a mining lease or for any other purpose, the proposal has to be forwarded to the central government. Suppose it says 100 acres of lease has to be given or 100 hectares of lease has to be given to X. The powers of the central government is only to approve it or disapprove it. Approve it with conditions. They don't have powers to increase the area of the lease from 100 to even 101. They don't. It is approval. So whatever proposal comes from the state governments, they can approve it or reject it. They cannot increase the duration of the lease from, let us say, if it is 20 years, they can't make it 21 years. So the approval part is there. So regulatory function is performed by the central government. Yes, in the case of Wildlife Protection Act, after the 2006-07 amendment, that is when you had the National Tiger Conservation Authority was formed and tiger reserves were brought under, tiger reserves became a statutory sort of declared, notified tiger reserves became a, otherwise earlier they were only national parks and sanctuaries, and tiger reserves were administratively declared. They had no legal this thing. But after the tiger crisis, we have the tiger reserves also as a notified tiger reserve. Now there again, the powers have been, if you see under the Wildlife Protection Act, more powers have been taken by the central government in the regulation of tiger reserves, because they are now getting approvals of all the tiger conservation plans and all that, that which should be the core, which should be buffer, what all. These are now, so if you see, a lot of much more than desirable, what is desirable is being controlled by the central government, because it is the responsibility, ultimately it is the responsibility of the state governments to protect, preserve the forests, because it's their land. Beyond a certain point, if you interfere, then it becomes counterproductive. Because if the tiger population falls today, the central government will say it's because of you it is falling. See, they can blame. But when it rises, they take the credit. So there has to be a balance. I think in the case of management of tiger reserves, the balance has actually shifted slightly more towards the central government, more than it was desirable. But they were able to do it because they had the funds, the money. Now the situation has slightly changed. When this compensatory afforestation fund which has come, it is a huge amount. It actually belongs to the states, because wherever diversion of forest has taken place in the states, this fund accrues. This NPV and compensatory afforestation charges actually comes in their ledger. It is their money. The central government is only custodian. The use is actually, the plans how to use the fund is by the state government. So now if you see, the apart from the state budget for protection of forest and wildlife, this is an additional amount which is available to the state governments. Earlier, and this amount is actually that amount which they get when they divert forest lands for non-forest use. So it is their fund. Earlier, the states were totally dependent upon the central government. Not totally, to a very large extent, because the state's revenues started improving substantially after 2002 or 2003. You know, that was a period the state forest department budgets were very, very low earlier. But then their budgets have started increasing. They have been also allocating more funds towards forest protection and for other purposes also, because their general revenue started increasing. Earlier, they were dependent only on the largely on the central government. A large kitty used to come from central government. So the central government was able to have a greater say in the tiger reserve when they came into it. And since we lost in these two states, we lost tigers in total number. We had a population zero in Panna and we had in Sariska. So that was a jolt. So central government took it upon themselves that no, we should have more say in it so that this tragedy is not repeated. But I would still feel that there is a little more than necessary has come to the central government.
Okay, so there's another question that comes to my mind. Considering that we have this huge fund for wildlife protection and environment protection. Why is it that when there is a crisis situation like the present pandemic lockdown, for things like basic things like food supplies to many of the park staff, many guides, drivers, field workers who were on temporary daily wage contracts, money was not made available to national parks when it was such a pressing situation, and these people continued to work through the pandemic, through the lockdown to keep our forests safe, but we had to go fundraising and get them help from the outside. Why were these funds not used at this time for these?
See, when there is a very large fund, one tends to put in lot of conditions, checks and balances that they are not misused. So in the zeal to see to it that they are not misused, the strict guidelines which have been approved by the Supreme Court have been formulated by the ministry, which was approved by the court. And basically, this is an additional amount for the salaries and other things, for the salaries and all other ways and means. The money has to be provided by the state government, because if you there was a fear that the once this fund comes, the state government will withdraw most of the funding and budgeting which they do for forest protection. That would be
what
very dangerous.
What is the fund used for?
It's actually, I would say, one of the main, one of the very interesting and very critical, I would say, is for consolidation of protected areas.
Okay.
So once you, one is of course allowing natural regeneration of when you have compensatory afforestation, you don't do the pit and plant, because then you, it's like a garden you are creating. You see, natural regeneration is by planting a pioneer species in an area, give it protection and allow the ecological succession to take place. Then you have a secondary forest, and then, you know, over a period of time you have a good forest, mixed forest comes in rather than a monoculture. Pit and plant, there is a danger of, you know, in a one row, it's like a garden. It's a very, so the idea was not to have pit and plant. You know, we need to have a natural forest regeneration, which of course requires less funding rather than pit and plant, because then you have to. That was one. But one of the greatest use which this fund can be used is for consolidation of protected areas, translocating people. Now, people who have been living historically in isolation, geographical isolation, economic, social isolation, they are away from all the amenities because they are in remote areas. So a lot of people are coming out, and it's a very difficult task, because law says that you can acquire it, those lands, but at that time there was no money to do it. Today we don't want to acquire it, that's why we go step outside the legal framework and we try to persuade people so that they have a better life. Their schools are closer, economic opportunities are accessible to them, and their geographical isolation ends. Lot of villagers have come out and they've actually, their life is much better after coming out. In emergency, they during rains. I must compliment the state like Orissa and Madhya Pradesh and some other states which have Maharashtra. They have taken this. It's a very difficult task, translocating, and they have done an excellent work. The villagers who have come out are very happy. The areas have, otherwise it's a lose-lose situation. There is a conflict with wildlife inside. They are inside, deep inside forest. If they have their, see, there's a crop raiding and all those problems are there. So once they are outside, they are able to live peacefully, have their vocation, agriculture activities and all that. And other activities also they can do. Nearby towns, they can go and work, supplement their income. So this, apart from, so I'm saying law up to a point is okay. But we need to go beyond it, and then whatever this fund is, it is being utilized. And I must say, many states have used their own funds and not utilized this money for consolidation of protected areas. And I must really compliment them. The kind of work they have done is amazing. And the people are happy. They've got land for land. They've got additional amounts. They've got for houses, for all other things. So if this is a win-win situation. And if in this way we will be able to have large areas which are consolidated and protected, the integrity of the protected areas will be maintained, the forest will, the wildlife will thrive there. Many of these areas where villages have been shifted, they have become the best grasslands and meadows where the population explosion has taken place. See, Rajaji, amazing. Amazing. It's a revelation. You see how things have improved. So beyond, you have to go beyond the act, the yes. laws.
Yes. But coming back to big cats, can you tell us some judgments which have really impacted on habitats for big cats in the country positively? And can you talk to us about some of the landmark judgments that have affected the protection of forests in India? Anything that you can share with us?
The Supreme Court in the forest matter on 12-12-96 passed a landmark interim order where the earlier the Forest Conservation Act was used in a very, very limited. It was used for a much larger area and where the forest diversion cannot take place without. So now your activities have been very strictly regulated. By paying, earlier you used to pay compensatory afforestation charges, but because of addition NPV which has to be paid, net present value is basically a project proponent pays. I'll tell you how it works. The project proponent pays for compensatory afforestation for the area, equivalent area he gives, and that is afforested. But that afforestation will take place at least 40-50 years for the forest to come around. But today you've lost it. You've lost the services which a forest gives. So the NPV, net present value, is taking upfront the value of those monetized value and taking that money. With the result that the diversion earlier, if you one, I suppose a particular project proponent needed only about 100 hectares, very extravagantly they used to ask for 200 hectares because compensatory afforestation charges at that time were not very high. But after NPV has come, the project proponent actually takes only that much area is actually required, not additional areas in a very extravagant manner. So this has actually reduced the demand for forest lands because of the, they have to pay through the nose, or sometimes, though the rates are not now very high considering the inflation and all that, but it's there is a case for revision of those rates. So one is that, so your diversions have come down. Secondly, after 14-2-2000, you cannot remove even grass from the national park sanctuaries. Trees, felling of trees, pulling out these have actually helped in national park sanctuaries, that you cannot do things because Section 29 says of the Wildlife Protection that you cannot remove unless it benefits, is in the interest of wildlife. You cannot remove any forest produce, or you can't use an area. Basically, if you use an area, you're removing something, whether you are making a road or all that. So there is, after 14-2000, there is a very strict, for 15 years up to October 5th October 2015, the Supreme Court was looking at it very closely. Each diversion in national park sanctuaries, was Supreme Court was approving those diversions under strict conditions. So if you see, a very large area came under very strict regulation and under with lot of mitigation measures and all, 5% of the project cost had to be paid by the project proponent for the using that area. For instance, Power Grid Corporation, they paid 50 crores for a project which was 750 crores. They paid 50 crores to Rajaji National Park for cutting down 7,500 odd trees. So initially 5% of the project cost was being paid by the project proponents by using the protected area lands. So if you see, with such strict regulation, what happened was that private enterprise, mining, everything stopped, and the areas have actually come up very well. The lot of disturbance which used to take place, which were not non-essential activities which would take place, now only public utility projects were allowed after strict scrutiny. So if you see, a very largely the habitats which improved in our protected areas in the last 15 years is attributed to the Supreme Court scrutiny. the scrutiny which they went, and the in each case was looked at by the Supreme Court. After it came from the National Board for Wildlife Standing Committee and the Central Empowered Committee constituted by the Supreme Court, when they looked and they gave the recommendations, only under those conditions those were allowed. So if you see these, if these habitats improved, the prey species improved, the large cats improved. The number which today has increased, tiger numbers, which we talk of improvement in tiger's number and increase in tiger numbers, is actually because of the 15 years of very strict regulation. So this is what we say is, this is actually attributed to them. And of course, the state governments have worked. There's no doubt about it. Even the central government has also worked for it. There's no doubt about it.
Fantastic. A lot of people also question the rule of law in helping controlling trade in wildlife, both within the country and trade across international borders. Can you tell us something about that?
See, the trade part is something which actually the demand is being generated. I believe after the corona, our poor pangolins have got a respite. So if we we need more of these things. I don't think so. We don't need more coronas to save our species. But the fact is that most of the demands are fake demands. There is no scientific reason for using any animal part that it has a medicinal property unless it is proven. Even it is proven, there is no need to kill any animal for any for treating any disease. So on ethical side, you know, but a large, when if you talk about that, then you can go into six that why not, if you can kill domestic animals for food, so why not wildlife? So when we go into an area which is very difficult, but the trade is actually is a problem because of the demands which are, and these demands are actually spurious demand. There's no need to have those animals killed. Now, how do we stop that? So if it is demand driven, if the demand is there, the animals will be killed and there will be trade in that. The demand, how do you reduce the demand? You cannot put forest guards, armed forest guards all around. What have you done in South Africa? In spite of putting guards almost after every rhino, the rhinos are still being killed. Look at the elephants. I believe in the 90s, there were about 70s, mid-70s, there were about 1,300,000 elephants in Africa. In 10 years, they came down to 7. So, it's demand. It's the demand. That's the problem. Now, you cannot have armies guarding wildlife. It's very difficult.
But they did have it in Nepal and they've done it successfully. So, what is it that's the difference between India and Nepal, with them being able to use the army and us?
In Nepal, they've only must have used in one or two areas, maybe Chitwan or some other places. If you have, our protected areas are much longer. Our population is more, villages are inside. I don't think that we can totally eliminate by putting guards. It's very difficult to, how many guards you can put, it's very difficult.
So, but what about also, what about transboundary trade? What are the rules that we have in India to help with something like that?
Our problem is any animal which is poached in India, killed in India, cannot be poached. So we have to secure our and in this particular kind of activity, the best thing is intelligence. It's a prevention is better than, what's the point in catching a poacher or a trader after the animal is killed? You've lost the animal. So, yes, you need a lot of intelligence work rather than put soldiers with or guards with arms and ammunition. Better option is to have a better intelligence network and get before the poachers get. You see, it's worked. In Assam, some time back, we were losing almost 1 week. Every week, we used to lose a rhino. Subsequently, they tightened. You have an example why I go to Nepal. Without soldiers, without guns and soldiers, Assam have shown that in the last 4-5 years, the rate of the mortality and the killing of rhinos have come down drastically, because it was put in the as a very important focus was put on by the government. So if you do that, you can still do without having an army of people going there. So it's the intelligence which has worked. You have to focus and attack that very area which is vulnerable, and then you try to stop it.
So tell us about Law E. How did it form? What was the thought? What is the work it do?
See, this actually, it was basically the lawyers got together because we thought that, I'll give you a very interesting example. In the 80s, when I became a member of the State Wildlife Advisory Board, Rajasthan, I asked one of the chief wildlife wardens that, do you have a copy of the Wildlife Protection Act? He didn't have a copy of a Wildlife Protection Act in his office. And I asked others also, and other chief wildlife wardens, I asked that the act was actually not being looked at. It only became, people started reading and buying act, and they started publishing in large numbers when there was a black buck incident in Rajasthan. Mm-hmm. That poaching incident in Rajasthan. That's when people started looking at that as an act. What we are saying, when at that time when this forest bench started, even before that when we had some judgments like Pradeep Kishan versus Union of India for stopping the collection of Tendu leaves from national park sanctuaries from 95, we found that there is an area which we should explore in the courts, that they should supplement. So we did go to the courts, and the law came together, we all got together, and we started not only, it's not litigation, we were not interested only in litigation, we were interested in actually making people aware. Like I said, people were not aware of the Wildlife Protection Act. So we then started having workshops with the rangers and officers of the for enforcement, that how to, because cases, our problem was and is still today, that the cases fail in the court. The poaching cases, the poachers get away with, they fail in the court because people are not trained to prosecute, trained to collect evidence, trained to do all these things which are absolutely necessary to get a conviction. So if you don't get conviction, there's no point in pursuing the case, just going through the motions. So the LOI that time, Legal Action for Wildlife and Environment, thought that we should actually try to, we had some very good experienced criminal lawyers and other, and we understood a little bit about that also, and we have very good lawyers. And we went to states, sat in the under the trees, spoke to the guards, spoke to the rangers, spoke to the, how they should pursue the case. They were complaining that, we have to go to the courts again and again, and it is very tedious, and it is a very slow moving process. So I told them, if it is so for you, because it's your duty to do it, what about the other person who's being prosecuted? He is also going through the same pain. So you should actually see to it that if you prepare the case well, if you collect the evidence properly, have all the reports properly, then you can get a conviction. So our idea was that, it should not be a going through the motion exercise, rather than we must get conviction. So that is one part. So that also was one of the things. We were also advising the various states, interacting with the states, going to the Wildlife Institute of India, going to the Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy, meeting with the forest officers, exchanging our views and getting their views, and having a good exchange of views on various policies, law, management practices about wildlife. So all these things, it was a good exchange, it was a very healthy exchange, and we learned a lot from that also. It's not that.
Fantastic. So the final question, will you tell us about the CEC, how it was formed and what role it plays? Things that people want to know about.
What is it? One is the CEC.
And the Green Tribune.
The CEC actually was formed by the court because a large number of cases were, and the Supreme Court wanted to streamline a lot of things. Sawmills, wood waste industries was a problem. They had to streamline, going through the projects of national park sanctuaries, So this was actually formed because the National Board for Wildlife was formed. It became a statutory authority only in 2003. Before that, it was only a club of people, ministries. Before that, states were having their state boards. But the National Board for Wildlife only was formed in 2003 after the amendments. So the CEC was assisting the court in all these matters. The court formed a committee that said, we can't look into this, but we would like to streamline many things. Because states were actually there, a lot of different problems were there. So the CEC assisted the court in streamlining many of these issues, and they used to give recommendations to the court, and the court used to then hear those recommendations, hear the parties, and pass orders, appropriate orders. So this is how the CEC was formed, and this is how it assisted the court. But ultimately, it is the court which was actually, we give the entire today the jurisprudence which has developed. It is the Supreme Court which has actually given us the way how to deal with these issues, how to strike a balance, because we can't stop. There is a compulsion to develop. You can't stop development in India because our roads have not reached people. Our people are still, they need electricity, they need water, they need water pipelines through the parks, they need, you know, all those optical fiber. We can't stop all these. Many of the things are absolutely necessary for this thing. So the court was able to strike that balance, and we also learned how to give our recommendation in a way which could strike a balance, and the court was able to guide us that how you should strike a balance. So for us, it was a very learning experience. It was a great honor and privilege to assist the Supreme Court of India. So and in the process, a lot of things got streamlined. And in this, the states also played a role. The central government also played a great role in seeing that, you know, yes, because after all, they are our major stakeholders. So it is without that, it couldn't have happened. It is all the states, the central government, and the CEC, we all sat together and tried to solve problems. And most of the time, we were able to find some way out.
Wonderful. So last question, if people are really interested in becoming lawyers that work on the environment, how do you recommend they do this? Can you give us a little bit on that? Because I think a lot of people watching this will want to know that.
You see, I'm a naturalist first. I became a lawyer by accident later on. But I would not ask people to take up environmental law or anything. I want, let people pursue law, become good lawyers. When they establish themselves as lawyers, they should take these activities. If at all they have time and inclination, then they should take up the legal environmental law as one of their this thing. But I would never ask any, because otherwise it would be very difficult to run their kitchen. You see, if they only become environmental lawyers to protect environment, how will they survive? I know what difficulties we all face because we always want to see to it that these projects should sort of not do these things and not do that thing. And, you know, sometimes we overreact also. Sometimes we need to first. So I would advise youngsters that they should become lawyers, establish themselves as lawyers, and then they should take up issues which are important, where they should be able to strike a balance, not just go whole hog, say that this should not be done and that should not be done, but never become an environmental lawyer. You take Mr. Salve's example. He's an established lawyer. Now, after establishing himself as a lawyer, he has a credibility and a very, very fine, sharp mind he has, amazing. And we were so lucky that we were able to have his assistance, I mean his guidance in shaping the reliefs which we wanted. So you need a person of that credibility to stand up and say, so I don't want youngsters to go and become environment green lawyers. No, they won't be able to survive even a year. So let them become lawyers and then take up the, once they establish, then take up the issues. If they feel that yes, these issues should be taken up, they should take up those issues. Green Tribunal is also there, they should, but Green Tribunal doesn't deal with wildlife. It deals with forests, it deals with environmental issues. So definitely a lot of young lawyers have gone and honed their skills in Green Tribunal. It's a good platform to, it's a very good forum to very diverse issues, environmental clearances and all. A lot of people have gone there and they've actually done well.
Fantastic. Thank you for this. It's just been amazing. I think this was something that very few people really talk about when they talk about big cat conservation. And we really needed to know that this side also exists and how important it is in our daily lives. Thank you so much for making the time.
One more last word from me is there are small cats. I would hesitate to use the lesser cats. Except these lesser mortals. The small cats also should also get the same attention.
We've actually been throughout this series, which I'll share with you. In fact, just this morning we were talking to Priya Singh, who has been doing research on clouded leopard. But with the clouded leopard, she's also got data on the marble cat and the leopard cat. We have been talking about it, the golden cat as well. In this particular series, because we were going across the world, we've chosen to look at the large. It was just a decision that we had taken. Maybe in the next series, we can take up the other cats, the middle and small cats. But we also may end up doing something on some of the dogs, because they're just so amazing.
Yeah, so amazing. But yes, the issue of conflict is something, the man-animal conflict, as we are growing, demand for land is growing.
Yes.
The conflict situation is one of the very, very critical areas, which you need to look at.
So in fact, it was very interesting, because Kirti Karant and I were talking, and Kriti said, it's strange that a measure of your success is increase in a cat population. But the increase of cat population in limited areas causes a spillover into human-dominated landscapes, and then causes a problem with cats trying to eke out a survival in that situation. So it's not really a conflict. It's not that they're going out there to have a fight, but it's just that they end up in a situation where they just have to use all of their skills to fight tooth and nail just for maintaining, We need to understand that and deal with it accordingly.
See, you have delineated areas. You have marked on the ground which they don't know that beyond this I should not go. The cats, the animals don't know that. This is your boundaries you have created, not they have not created. You encroached into their areas, we have encroached.
Yes.
So we can't blame them fully.
Absolutely.
We can't blame them.
Absolutely. So, yes.
So, thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
The tourism benefits can be driven to the local community as well.